Michael York, welcome to the programme. I chose that particular clip of film for several reasons. Could you hazard a guess, as young Carruthers might have said, what those reasons might be?
Now you've put me on the spot. Well, I suppose it's a good clip because it illustrates basically what the film is about.
It's a jolly good entrance for you as well, of course, coming up through the hatch there. And the story is told from your point of view, from Carruthers' point of view.
Yes, he's the in the book, he's the narrator.
Yes.
And in a way, they've used these voiceover devices, which work very well in the same way.
Did you read first the film script or the book?
Oh, I read the book as a child. I remember it was on the list of favourite books. I think it was the Sunday Times. And I went out and bought a second-hand copy and was riveted. And there have been plans to film it over the years, and Hollywood films and so on. And so I was very glad to be associated with our effort, which is all British.
And of course, you're very glad they didn't film it sooner, because this is almost a childhood dream then coming true. It's an adventure story from your boyhood, and here you are playing the main character in it. How would you describe, without giving too many secrets away, who Carruthers is exactly, and how he came to be on this yacht, the Dulce Bella?
Well, the story's about two young men, Carruthers and Davis, both friends at Oxford. And Davis, on a sailing holiday, he's one of the yachtsmen to the manor born, and it's in his blood. He discovers something nasty going on and asks Carruthers to join him on a sailing holiday. Carruthers thinks that he's going to be invited on a grand yacht with some comfort and style, as you see, is on that little tiny...
Yes, and of course, you don't really come dressed for that part, do you? You're more dressed for sort of cows in the yachting season with a crew. Yeah.
And between them, they both, in fact, do discover a plot. And what it is, it's... in fact, no less than the Kaiser of Germany, planning an invasion of England by means of towing soldiers out on barges in these very flat, shallow waters around the Frisian Islands on the north coast of Germany, across to the east coast of England, which at that point was undefended. There were no coastal defences, and the book had this historical significance because questions were asked in the Houses of Parliament after it appeared, and in fact, the Royal Navy was relocated to defend the East Coast. In a way, it was prophetic because, 10 years later, the First World War came.
Well, that's probably one of the main reasons why it would be described as the most important spy story ever written, because it's not often that governments act on the conclusions drawn from a work of fiction.
That's quite true, yes.
And in fact, there were bases, were there not, built at that time that were, in fact, then ready for World War I?
Exactly, yes.
What about the sailing, Michael? Is that one of your hobbies?
Well, I always thought, the marvellous thing about doing films, you get a chance to do all kinds of unusual things besides going to unusual places, and you get to learn to fence. And I was always intrigued about sailing because it was something I'd never really done. I wanted to take a boat around the palace pier and so on. And I wondered if, like Ted Heath, a sudden passion would overwhelm me and one would find one's true vocation. But like Carruthers, I'm afraid, I was very, very much typecast. It was... very much take it or leave it.
So it was very useful, in fact, not to be a very good sailor in this.
Oh, that wasn't acting, no. Whereas, on the other hand, Simon McCockindale was Davis to the life. I mean, he loved it. He took a course. He was up and down that boat shouting orders at me.
I'm
quite right.
What about your character? Did you find anything in your own background to draw? How would you describe Carruthers as a character?
It's...
in a few
looking
words.
Looking back, in a few words, he's one of those... quintessential upright Englishman that I suppose still exist. The dress and the haircuts have changed, but they still go on.
Yes.
With a passionate love of his country and a sense of outrage that it should be threatened, its safety, and everything it stood for should be threatened by a brutal, oppressive power.
And is there something of that in your nature as well? Or do you think that's
old-fashioned? Oh, I think so, in all of us. I mean, should that terrible day arise when we are threatened militarily again, I think we'll all rally around and defend what's nearest and dear to us.
I think that's probably the most important thing about the British character, in fact. Now, I remember you've quite recently, I think, played Hamlet, haven't you?
And well, recently it was...
a few years ago, was
1970,
it?
1970, yes.
I see.
Yes.
There is a line in that, as I remember, which you could probably quote better than me.
Oh,
bear Hamlet like a soldier...
Oh, like a soldier to the grave, for he was likely, had he been put on, to have proved most royally.
Now, do you think, you're more or less saying now, that if you had been placed in that situation all those years ago, that your true British grit would probably rise to the occasion and you would do what what Carruthers did.
Gosh, what can I say? I hope so.
I hope we all would.
I hope
Michael York, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. And